Hello, everyone. This is Seamus McGarvey, and you're listening to Cinepod, the cinematography podcast.
The following podcast contains explicit language. You're listening to the Cinematography Podcast presented by Hot Rod Cameras, a program about the art, craft, and philosophy of the moving image and the people who make it happen. Coming to you from the world headquarters of Hot Rod Cameras in Hollywood, California, are your hosts, Ben Rock and Ilya Friedman.
Hey, Ben Rock, producer, director. Man about town, man's ladies man.
Hey, Ilya Friedman, fine proprietor at Hot Rod Cameras. How you doing?
Yeah, you know, it's the holidays. It's an interesting time of year. Lots of stuff going on. Very pleased that we've got another episode coming out right now. In fact, one of our returning champions, Seamus McGarvey. This is his third time.
Seamus McGarvey.
Yeah.
So awesome.
You interviewed him once. I interviewed him once. And then we interviewed him together on this last one. Yeah, it was great.
Yeah. Thesis, antithesis, synthesis for all you Hegelians out there. So it was very, very exciting to talk to Seamus McGarvey. And I point this out in the interview. Seamus is somebody who makes filmmaking sound like fun. And you get the sense that he just loves doing it. Like he, you know, I just love the spirit he brings to his work. And his new work, of course, is Cyrano, the musical adaptation of Cyrano de Bergerac, starring Peter Dinklage. Just an absolutely beautiful film. It was interesting for me because once upon a time when I was a makeup artist, I actually made the nose for a Cyrano de Bergerac play at the Civic Theater of Central Florida once upon a time. But this is a Cyrano with no nose. It's Peter Dinklage with a normal sized nose, and it is a musical. A lot of musicals this year, and it's just gorgeous. Seamus's work is just beautiful and sensual. Just looks like a giant cheesecake. It's so amazing.
Now we do have a close focus, but we're going to save it till after the interview this time, and so we're going to mix it up a little bit. So without further ado, here's our interview with Seamus McGarvey.
The Cinematography Podcast Interview.
We are here with our third time returning champion, Seamus McGarvey. Holy crap, thank you so much for coming back on the show. We always love to talk to you, and your work never disappoints. And you currently have the new movie Cyrano, which is just gorgeous, gorgeous film. So thank you very much for coming on the show.
Thanks for the invitation, Ben. Hi, Ilya. It's good to see you.
No, it's great to see you too. And Cyrano de Bergerac is a story that's been told, you know, before on film. I think the last version that I know of, at least, was the Gerard Depardieu version that came out in the 90s. There was also Roxanne with Steve Martin. Your version has a very different look and feel from anyone that I've ever seen before. Can you talk about what were your inspirations, and did you look even at the other Cyranos that are already out there?
Well, I remember them, but we didn't sort of specifically look at them and study them for our film. Our film had closer roots to the stage play written by Erica Schmidt from the original manuscript. And that starred Mr. Dinklage and Mr. Yeah. Bell. So we had a different starting point than those previous movies. And it was interesting to sit down with Joe and just mull over how we would depict the story. And I suppose the big difference is that it's a musical. So that kind of led us into a particular style because the music has a particular feel. So I suppose two things guided us initially. And one was the soundtrack, the script, but then also the place itself where we were shooting was Sicily. And that was just wondrous.
Was that location already kind of baked in when you came on the project, or was that something that you guys sought out?
Sarah Greenwood, our designer, knew about it, had visited it and suggested it to Joe. And they went on a preliminary recce, Scott, and immediately recognized this was, I think, pre-pandemic, that it would be the perfect place. But then, weirdly, its geography worked so well in our favor once the film was greenlit, because all of Italy was in a lockdown and Sicily, you know, is an island. And we just basically created a little bubble of people, a troop of actors, technicians. And we went to this place, this town of Noto, a beautiful honey sandstone colored town. And there was nobody around. We basically, it was this place had been demolished by an earthquake in 1692. So it had been rebuilt with a kind of a cohesive vision. So in the absence of tourists, cars, anybody really, it just felt like it had been designed by, it was a backlot production design. We had the run of the place day and night.
That's great.
Yeah, it was great.
There's going to be a lot more productions now aiming to start up there. I think there's going to be a whole cottage industries, you know, plot. I mean, wow, that's incredible.
Yeah, I just loved being there. There were also none of the distractions of bars or, you know, restaurants, that sort of thing, because everything was closed. So it lent this really strange, almost monastic focus on the film that we, you know, we would go to the beach at the weekends maybe, but everything else was kind of dormant.
You know, I think that anytime someone looks to adapt a stage musical, there's probably a bit of fear and trepidation because there's a lot that have come before. And I think everyone hopes that the movie version might be successful like a Grease and not end up like a Cats. I mean, it's so musicals, which work so well in person, don't always necessarily translate. Can you talk about a little bit about the process of you're going, okay, so this is a, you know, a fantastic off-Broadway production. How do we turn this into the movie version? What was that sort of discussion like?
Well, again, we were guided by the material, by the songs, which are more laconic and lyrical. It's not in the style of Hooray for Hollywood musicals. And, you know, I've worked on films that are more proscenium style and whoosh, like Greatest Showman, which had great songs in it, but it was definitely more of a spectacle when we did musical numbers. For this, it was defined by Joe being very clear that the dialogue would roll into the song and out again, and that moreover, the dialogue and the song particularly was recorded live right there.
So, oh, really?
Yeah. I mean, everything was all the timbre and the quavers and the accidents that happen in the voice and the performance effectively sort of leads you to into the character. So that for them being able to sing a song is just wonderful.
There's a real intimacy to that too. Like, you know, when you bring up The Greatest Showman, yeah, that's like a big showstopper. It feels like you're at a giant Broadway show, but this, you kind of feel like you're in the room with them. You know, it feels like very intimate. Now, did that guide the way that you chose to stage it or light it or lens selection, any of those things?
Yes. You know, we had decided early on, we had to issue film to shoot on because there was no way of getting celluloid out to a laboratory and back in again during the pandemic. Everything was just in lockdown. So digital was our friend, worked really well for us. So we shot large format LF, Alexa LF, and we shot with lights lenses. And what I really loved about it was feeling that it was medium format portraiture, you know, we knew that we were going to, for a large part of it, although we have great vistas in the movie, that we were really going to be focusing in on the face, on the performance of the stuff. And no better faces than Dinklage and Bennett.
No, you had a great cast.
Jr. Yeah.
And it had kind of a Barry Lyndon, dare I say, a Barry Lyndon-esque, like very low light feel. Maybe that has to do with the large format and the shallow depth of field. But can you talk about the visual touchstones you had thought about? Like what were the things you were going for? What was True North?
Well, yeah, at the start of the film, we had this sort of sense of brio and light and overexposure and halation, and we wanted movement and kineticism. Mm-hmm. Just to show the innocence and the kind of excitement of love. And then obviously, as we go through it, things start torquing a little bit into a more, well, nocturnal feel for one, but also certainly more stasis in terms of the camera movement. Mm-hmm. And we were also the only set that we built, or Sarah Greenwood and her team built, was the theater, which was built in our hotel car park, basically. And we built it outdoors for COVID reasons so that people could all, you know, mingle, and everyone had masks on Joe's mom made all these sort of medieval masks that had real N95s underneath.
So. Oh, that's brilliant.
So that everyone was kind of safe, and we were sort of careful with the shots so that we didn't have to. But there were 150 extras, but being outdoors, it helped them. I think we had one COVID case up in the rafters who was sort of similarly out of the building. But the rest of the locations were real locations. They were the palazzo that we shot Roxanne's apartment in. It was somebody's house, I should say. It was like a 35-room palazzo. But and all the other locations were real. So in doing so, particularly in night scenes, you're working with candles, but they were sort of gently enhanced. The sources that we were using were right up against walls, you know. So
yeah. I'm also thinking about, like, there's that scene when Cyrano's going down the staircase and it's lit by torchlight and he's sort of being attacked from every direction. And I'm like looking at that scene thinking it felt like it was lit by those torches, which I know is your intention, but I was curious if it was.
Well, it was. I mean, I'd have liked to project the shadow of Cyrano coming up the stairs. Mm. But then once they get into that altercation, it was real flame.
That's so awesome.
I had some lights in the background, but the only difference was, I tell a slight porcupine about that. Because Dinklage, Cyrano, has the two torches, flaming torches, and he attacks people with them and actually throws them at a stuntman who bursts into flames. And obviously to do that, you can't use the real stuff, even with stunties, certainly not with an A-list actor like Peter Dinklage. So I had Sparks in Britain, Lee Walters and the team built these LED torches. So we just used that. Those are the sources.
That was brilliant. So the flame on those torches in particular, I guess, is added in post somehow.
Yeah, they're CG flames, and we had to make the LED small enough so that they could wrap a flame around it.
Now I need to go watch it again to see if I can spot it, because like I was watching that scene like a hawk. I'm like, this all looks like it was lit by these torches. So I was kind of right, but no, that's brilliant. That's so cool. And if you'd shot on film, I don't know that there's a film stock that would have been sensitive enough to do what you were describing, is there?
No. Well, you'd have to push it, so it wouldn't have that. It would have been quite grainy at that low level. But actually, I was very impressed at how well the flames actually read. You know, sometimes on digital, when you're shooting wide open like that, pretty much wide open, it burns out white. Yeah. And we still had color. And that scene was heavily rehearsed. So even though it's apparently one shot, there are wipes in there, you know, that obviously flames come past.
Yeah.
There's a few quick pans that help us cut between it. And Eunice Huthart, who's our stunt coordinator, she sort of shot it on the mobile phone, which is always a danger in rehearsals. Mm. So she basically, along with Joe and I, basically blocked that scene and to that real staircase. And then we had a great second unit director, stroke DP, Kate Arismendi, who you will know, I'm sure. And she's just amazing. So we shot a few days and she finished it off with all the cutaways and the fight and the people coming over the edge and Cyrano looking back at De Guiche. So we had Kate throughout the whole film and she did some extraordinary work. I've got to give her a shout out.
That's great. And I think second unit doesn't always get its due and the amount of work that they do. And I once talked to Todd Halliwell, who had done second unit for Ron Howard on a number of movies. And he said on Apollo 13, he made up T-shirts that said, if it was easy, first unit would have done it.
And
and gave that to them. So I always think it's interesting, you know, because like the place of second unit in a movie like this and what they can do and how much they can kind of back you up. Can you talk more about how you go about working with a second unit?
Well, it's different every film. And sometimes, you know, if it is an action movie, obviously those people who shoot that sort of stuff know it inside out. And it's extraordinary. It's not the sort of cinematography I can even conceive of or think about. So that's when I love having the second unit. Here was very different because Kate is a brilliant cinematographer. She was directing the second unit on this one as well as shooting. And where Kate really came into her own was that she and Haley had worked together on Swallow with Joe Wright.
It's a great film too. I love that movie.
Loved it.
Super creepy.
Really. And so that rapport that they had and the intimacy as friends was really great, because Joe and I did certain sequences, but a few times in the film, we left Haley and Kate together in the room, and off they went doing really kind of languid, light suffused shots that could only happen between two people who are really close and comfortable with each other. It's quite intimate stuff. So that became part of the every letter sequence in a very lovely form of light.
Oh, that's okay. I know exactly the sequence you're talking about.
She's on the bed and the grip and all the blue flares and everything.
Oh, it's beautiful stuff too. We should get her on at some point. She did great work on that. And you brought up something that I actually that kept popping out at me as I was watching the movie, is that I think in a post Children of Men world, there's a tendency to want to do crazy long takes, but a lot of times they draw attention to themselves. And I was watching the movie and I just kept noticing that they were never like, oh, hey, look at, I can do this with the camera. It was more just like, we're going to tell as much as we can in one brilliantly choreographed sequence. And the sequence work was phenomenal. Was that an idea that was brought to you? Was that your idea? And like, how do you go about even executing? Like, how much rehearsal goes into some of those? Because some of them have dozens of extras and stuff in them.
I'm usually not a great fan of big, long shots. And here's from the fellow who shot Atonement. But all that stuff Joe conceives of, really. And one of the integral parts of cinema for Joe is rhythm. The extension of it, the stretching of it, and the breaking of it, and the speeding up of it. And that's particularly when that's in kind of concert with song. It's very potent when you can play with those kind of rhythmic elements to photography alongside sound and song. So Joe really has a great metronomic head about him. He can almost, like, I can tell when we're storyboarding, he's storyboarding, there's a beat to the pictures themselves. And usually the form of the film is very close to Joe's little stick insect storyboards that he does. And that lovely sort of choreography between actor, camera, director, light, all coalesces.
I've got a question that directly fits into what you're talking about right now. You said that you're recording the performances, the singing performances on set as the actors are doing it. Typically, of course, for any of our listeners who aren't aware, usually there's playback and lip sync going on, but because of they're recording their actual performances, I'm assuming they've got some sort of earbud which is playing back music, because you can't exactly have all the music playing live too, or otherwise that would ruin the recording. And I have to imagine that you can only get so many takes of this too, and it's going to just be so incredibly taxing for the talent in particular to have to sing these songs, these big numbers, over and over again. So tell us just a little bit about what extra strife it sounds like you must have had to go through because you guys had made a commitment to do it this way.
Well, there were a lot of earwigs, and you know, like the Fort Maniache when all the soldiers are dancing, like all those soldiers need to have the music in their heads, but we can't play it back because, you know, Christian's actually singing the song live. So we had like 100 earwigs. Yeah, it was fantastically complicated to achieve.
So I would imagine that it was multi-camera during most of these performances so that you didn't have to then reset and do it all from another angle if you needed to cut to something else, or how did you?
We had two cameras, which we rarely use two cameras, but that one in the fort where all the soldiers are dancing, Kate was on a camera, a profile shot at the same time, just out of shot. But almost, I would say 85% of the movie was done with a single camera.
Oh, wow. And this isn't really as much of a cinematography question, but I'm very curious about it. You can't obviously have actors singing their heart out for a 12-hour day. So did doing the live performance limit how much singing, or did when you were scheduling it, was it like, well, we can only spend 3 hours on a scene that involves singing and then we'll do other stuff? Or how did you break that up?
The actors nailed it every time. I mean, they're all such strong singers. And, you know, we didn't have enough time to shoot it. I mean, it was quite a fast shoot, I think 50 days. That's probably why there are quite a lot of single shots of when the singing happens. They're like, maybe we cover it from three angles, if that. we were economical with our time. And usually, I mean, Joe doesn't like a lot of takes anyway. And with if you're working with actors of the caliber we were working with, you know, you're only looking for different options. It's not like, oh, they messed up.
I'm just afraid, like, and I've done a lot of theater work. It's like, I'm just afraid, you know, you're going to blow out someone's voice if you make them sing for 5 straight hours and it's, you know, a particularly difficult song. You know, if it's something that's like right in their register, maybe you can go a little longer, but eventually they just won't have voice if you make them sing all day.
Yeah, that's true. I think there was a lot of vocal training went into it and everyone was, but it became quite difficult up the hill, up the in Mount Etna when Kelvin Harrison Jr. had to sing that song and by the cannon, and it was brutally cold, like 20 degree, minus 20.
Oh man, minus 20.
Yes. Ugh. Yes. It was really, really cold.
It's awful. That stuff
the mountain erupted at the end of it. Like we literally ran off that thing.
Carrying what?
It erupted. Our whole set got covered in lava.
What?
Yeah, two to three days later, it was covered. Oh, but we had ash falling
on smoke.
And the mountain, I mean, it was Mount Etna, like you see it in those old paintings from the 18th century. It was like a red funnel of lava going spewing up into the air.
What?
That is insane. Like, did you have some kind of early warning system in case that happened while you were
shooting? The volcanologist kept saying, don't we know, like, minimum 3 days in advance, you'll be fine. And next thing we heard this, and it was just like, okay, it's a wrap. Let's get out of here.
Oh my God.
It is one of the world's most active volcanoes. It's like, it is.
That is horrifying. It's like the sword of Damocles hanging over you the whole shoot.
But it's almost like, Joe, when we went up that thing, it was still like the clouds were going when we went on a scout. And we were all looking at each other going like, Joe, are you sure about this? And Joe just loves those challenges. He really thinks that it forges something, literally. I mean, you know, but I didn't want to be forged.
Forged in a crucible of actual magma. Oh my God. That's intense. Cause I
wanted to ask about, like, cause that whole location and that whole kind of chapter of the movie, it looks very different than everything else in the movie. That just pulled me right in too. Cause it was so different than everything that came before it.
Well, it was just, we obviously had that nostalgic Sylvan Christian Dior 10 denier stockinged opening to the film. And then Joe always had this notion of that moment of Cyrano and Roxanne looking at each other, the cut from her face to the visceral monochromatic lithographic landscape was something that was one of the central kind of tent poles of his photographic and my photographic thinking of the film. And we just pulled all the filters off the camera, the glimmer glass, the nets, everything, and just shot deep focus with these beautiful lights lenses. And they're ultra sharp, unfiltered. But then in the DI, we further attenuated that and played with contrast and depth and, you know, vignetting and all that stuff. And there's some nice visual effects work in that as well, which maintained the continuity of the snow, because the snow we'd arrive in the morning and the place would be covered in snow. And then by mid-afternoon, the volcano heat had melted it off. So, you know, they had to do a lot of work to just extend the snow and to keep some sort of continuity, because it was a wee bit a bumpy ride in the rough cut.
Oh, man. It would be so hard for me to, like, tune out the fact that I was sitting on top of an active volcano all day long.
You know what you could do? I mean, I'll say minus 20. If when your hands got too cold, you just put it through the snow down into the sand, and it was like putting your hand in an oven. It was hot.
So the artificial snow that's being created on top for the scene, if you wanted to warm up, you just got underneath the snow, and then the sand was an oven. I just want to.
The conundrum of that, and you think that is cinema, that is filmmaking for you.
For real.
The artifice of that and the absolute craziness of it. If you told it to anybody else, it's only filmmaking to understand that madness.
It's just, I'm still taking it in.
Yeah, this is almost like a giant war story. It's like you don't believe that this is real unless you hear it from the people who were there. So it's like it just doesn't sound plausible that you go through this, but this other scenario is literally bubbling right under the surface. So,
but Ben, you were saying about that end coda bit, which I love that section, and
it's so good. I love that song too. That song was one of my favorites in the whole movie.
I got one question. I'm going to jump back in here. To me, it's very interesting the range of movies that started as a play, and this is another one just like that. It was a play. It was a musical. It becomes a movie. Are you guys conscious while you're making the movie? That do you start to think, this feels like we're watching a stage performance, or this feels more like a play? Do you ever think like, oh, we have to change what we're doing here, make it feel more like cinema? Or do you lean in more and say, you know what, we like this feeling of it? And it's a musical, so of course it completely shatters all willing suspension of disbelief anyway, because you're just, you know, you've got these people who, like, you know, they're so emotional, their heart is exploding, that it's time now to move into song. I know it's a conversation with you and Joe and potentially, you know, the writer and everything else. How do you guys walk that line and find that balance of how much cinema, how much play, how does it become this new thing?
Well, I suppose the play is intrinsic. In fact, the dialogue from the original play and from Erica Schmidt's adaptation of it are the soul of it, because they are infused with period of the time. And that kind of gives it the kind of the structure, the architecture of the time. Now, me and Joe and I's natural instincts is for veracity and naturalism in cinema, and them speaking in this kind of dialogue is sort of tempered by a more, I suppose it's more terrestrial approach to the photography.
That's interesting. And I even sort of felt like when I was watching it, in sort of towards the beginning, there's a scene that takes place in a theater, and that's not an uncommon thing to do in a play. You know, Hamlet obviously, most famously has that. But I almost felt like you were able to meta use that to comment on the fact that it was a play too. Like the point of that was sort of like, this actor is bullshit. And here's the real thing. When you're watching in a movie and you have a play in the movie, it automatically commented on it. I don't know if that was intentional or not.
No, absolutely. I mean, the surrounding cordon of set and costume and mise-en-scène is defiantly operatic and at times positively camp. It's kind of over the top and playful. And, you know, I know that Joe wanted it to be at least a vehicle for humor into the movie as well.
It's a funny story. There's a lot of humor in it.
I mean, the every letter sequence when we're in there, me and Joe are in there with flashlights, you know, flaring the camera, and we're all totally focused.
A gorgeous sequence.
We had great fun doing that, because we were like, when we got a particular flare, we were like, "Way!"
more of that. No, stop that.
I know it was a great morning's film in that. We just put down the shutters and sort of started playing with light and focus and everything, and everyone was having fun. Like, it reminds me of my days doing music videos as well, where you really get into the music and it becomes a sort of symbiosis of actor, camera, light and place, and everything works together, and everyone's having this little waltz with the dance.
You make it sound like so much fun. I mean, seriously.
Oh my God.
I know, but like, I feel like we get so serious about making movies and you make it sound like the most fun.
I think I'm sort of maybe slightly pathologically happy about being a cinematographer. So that takes me through the really fucking difficult times of being a cinematographer when shit is hitting the fan. I'm not just saying it's a joy the whole time. It can be real grueling times. But what really is the salve, the balm for that, is when you see a movie up there that actually works. I mean, I've worked on some turkeys, but like when a movie works, like Cyrano, I believe, definitely does. It makes everything worthwhile, all the little, and it's like an errant family when you're away with your cinema troupe you have little spats and arguments, and it's like dinner table kind of, well, he's got more peas than I had. You remember as a kid? All those things that families have with each other. Like, you've been in the toilet for the last half an hour, get out of there. All that stuff is forgotten about when you see the final movie.
I saw a meme the other day where someone was talking to a friend to a person. They said, "Oh, I made a friend the other day," and they said, "Wait a second, is it a real friend or a set friend?" And he goes, "Oh, it was a set friend." So, and it's like, but you know, it's true. You come together, you have a family, you go through all the things that a family has, and then you go your separate ways, and maybe you get to do it again someday. You get to do it again.
Before you do that, you run around on wild horses and torch the village and run out of town. I mean, it's not quite as like that, but it's kind of a good allegory.
Well, that's awesome. I think that's an amazing place to leave it. And again, you just make it sound like the most fun, which is what it should be. And also sometimes you're sitting on top of an active volcano, which it often is. But thank you. You're an inspiration and your work is amazing. Thanks for coming back on the show.
Thanks for asking me, Ben. Thanks, Ilya.
Our pleasure. So that was Seamus McGarvey. Thank you so much for coming back on the show, Seamus. Always great to talk to you. And everybody listening to The Sound of My Voice, please go check out Cyrano.
Cool. So mixing up our order a bit today, we start off right into the interview. Boom. Very little preamble, very little stuff. But now we're going to dive into Close Focus. Close Focus today. We actually have some unfortunate news. A good friend of the show, someone who'd been on the show before, Jean-Marc Vallier, unfortunately, tragically, suddenly passed away at the age of 58, just after Christmas. And
And for those of you who don't know his name off the top of your head, he was the director of Dallas Buyers Club, Sharp Objects, and Big Little Lies. And just an amazing filmmaker and a real tragic loss. And our hearts go out to, you know, obviously his family, people who knew him and people who worked with him. But also, you know, as film viewers, we got a lot of great work out of him over the years, and it's just a real loss. But Ilya, you had the opportunity to interview him a few years ago at South by Southwest, right?
I did, and it was a nice little interview, and I think we'll actually play a clip right here. So if you want to watch the whole thing, it's only a few minutes long. You can go to the Cam Noir website, and we'll have a link there where you can watch the whole thing. But we're going to play a little clip of it right now, and then we'll come back.
I'm being a little bit of a dictator and say, no, you can't use any reflector, any flag, any spot. I want the space for the actors and the story. Can you accept this? If you don't, I'm going to go to another guy. So the first thing he said is, okay, this is what you want to do. I'm going to try to make this work. How many DPs are ready to say yes to this? And to say, to style their images? I'm going to give priority to the director and his acting and his story. And then my images. All right, I'm going to do the available light thing and shoot 360. I'm going to control it here live on the spot and in post. Try to fix what we fuck up. It's a great space of freedom, and it's using the technique to serve that. Not put style there. We're aware that we're creating a style with this kind of thing, but it's not put it above what's important. First things first, and the first thing that is so important is the emotional content in the story.
So that was Jean-Marc Vallier on the Cinematography Podcast a few years ago at the South by Southwest Film Festival. I was really glad that I got the opportunity to chat with him, and he will be missed. He's a huge talent, for sure.
Serious, serious loss.
And now, Short Ends.
So Ben, since we've changed the order of things, it's now Short End time. Is there an obsession or something that you've got going on this week that you want to share with our listeners?
I do. And it was something that my wife had to kind of convince me to watch. It's a series on HBO Max that I wasn't too sure about it because I was like, too real. And it's called Station 11. and it's on HBO Max, and I guess a lot of people are watching it. I hadn't really heard that much about it. Like, I hadn't seen that much marketing on it. The thing about it is that makes it feel a little too real. I guess it's based on a book. It predates the pandemic, but it's about a pandemic that wipes out most of civilization. And it's, you know, not easy to watch given that we're still sort of dealing with this pandemic ourselves. But I have to say, it is absolutely gorgeous looking. The acting is really amazing. I guess the pandemic as portrayed in this movie is just more severe enough than the one we are still kind of, you know, hopefully almost out of, that because it's devastating. And I mean, it's like from the moment that everyone realizes there's a pandemic to like when the main characters lose all their family is seemingly, you know, a couple of days at most. Because of that, I feel like it's just that much more exaggerated. And it has a little bit of a feeling of what I used to love about J.J. Abrams' show Lost, in that, you know, you kind of meet these characters and then you kind of go back in time and figure out how they all got to where they got to. And there's just some amazing acting going on in it. And it looks great. It has kind of an epic feel in a sense, but also very personal. It kind of centers on one character. And so if you have HBO Max, I think it's a really good show to check out. I have to say that I've been kind of pacing myself with it because it is so close to real life that it's a little much to take all at once. So I haven't been binging it, but you know, I'll watch, you know, I came into it, I think, when like the fourth episode had dropped. So, you know, it was like, it was spaced it out by a day or so and I was okay. But it's really well done. I would love it if more people were talking about this show.
You know, I really like Mackenzie Davis, too. I thought she was a real highlight in Halt and Catch Fire. I really enjoyed that series, and I'm looking forward to her returning to a series like this. I don't think I've seen anything else with her except for maybe a couple of parts in movies since then, so I haven't seen her do another series, so this will be interesting.
Yeah, and I would love to make a shout out to the, there's three cinematographers on the series, Steve Kozins, Daniel Grant, and Christian Sprenger. They're all just doing amazing work. It's the kind of show that like is supposed to feel like the real world and big, interesting things are happening. And I love the approach, the visual approach to it.
I can't wait to check it out. I haven't seen it yet. So I'm looking forward to it.
Definitely give it a shot. So Ilya, what is your pet obsession of this week?
I'm back on lenses. You know, I think I've talked about it before. Some of the best, highest quality and cost-effective lenses that you can buy out there is from a company called Tokina. They're not a sponsor of the show, but they make some really fine lenses, and you know, we sell them over at Hot Rod.
I own a few Tokina lenses, love them a lot.
And you know, I am not taking credit for this, but the president of Tokina USA asked me a while ago what focal lengths I thought would be great for them to add to the set, to the lineup, and I'm pretty sure I said 29 and 21. And just today they announced they're going to come out with the 29 and the 21. So maybe I should just take all the credit for this, but I think that other
you
people
should. Now I got to know why those two specific focal lengths.
Okay. So they go 18 to 25 right now, and then to 35, which are pretty big jumps. And on the wider side in particular, you usually find cinematographers wanting more nuance, wanting more subtlety, wanting more variations. As you get longer focal lengths, it's really not as it's not as crucial to have so many options. But when you look at high-end professional sets that that have 10 focal lengths, 11 focal lengths, usually they're much more heavily weighted on focal lengths 40 and wider. Now the 18 that Tokina makes is amazing. It's also quite large, and I hope that the 21 and the 29 are both significantly smaller and lighter than the 18, which will really, I think, kind of change the fate of that set so much. The 25 is a fine size. It's not too big, but the 18 is. Now, granted, it's an incredible lens, but it's a big chunk of metal and glass to put on the front of a camera. So 21, 18, 21, 25, 29. Now there's a lot of focal lengths under 35. And you'll see this amongst all the major manufacturers. And it's because really you want to be able to fit in exactly the right dimensions. And when you're working with longer focal lengths, I think it's easier to cheat a little, to move a little, and to make it happen. When you're working in small, confined spaces, every millimeter counts. And if you don't want to be on a zoom for whatever reason, or you don't have the space for a zoom, having those wide angle primes is really key. And I love that Tokina is really paying attention. They're being used, these lenses are being used on Ted Lasso. And so if you like the way that show looks, it's you know, the whole show is shot on Tokina lenses, which is cool. So anyway, I think it's cool that a company out there is paying attention to the market, paying attention to what people are asking for, paying attention to what I'm
asking
for.
You.
Yeah, I know. It was nice. Yeah. I'll take it. It was like, I'm glad. I think the thing I said I really was 29. And then if they had the ability to throw in a 21, that they should do that too. But yeah, I'm glad they did it for both. 29 is a great focal length. It's really, really fantastic.
I need to go. I need to go to your place and look once they have it out. I would be interested to like throw the 29 and, you know, a 35 on two cameras and just kind of look at the difference and how subtle it is.
It's not that subtle, depending on how close you are to your subject. And a lot of DPs like to put the camera pretty close, and they really kind of render differently. Yeah,
I'm sure. Like you said, as you get wider, every millimeter really does make a big difference.
Yeah, just stick your face close to your webcam. You'll see how quickly that distortion and how that focal length matters. It really does change the way the face looks. It's pretty amazing.
I really hope you were the one that convinced them to do it. I think that's great.
Yeah, I hope so too. They listened to me last time with the 40 and the 65. So I guess it's no wonder they listened to me again. I guess those were pretty popular too. But for the people out there who are big fans and who really want a premium set of lenses at what is essentially a very modest price, it's really difficult to beat the Vistas. They're great lenses and cover, you know, full frame and beyond. They'll cover 65 millimeter, which is astounding.
That's awesome.
So Ben, it was a relatively short and sweet episode this week. Let's find out where people can get more Ben Rock in their life if they want it. Where can people find you?
Number one place, go to Facebook and join the Needs a Werewolf group and say hi and pitch me some of your movie ideas, adding a werewolf in. Other than that, please go to benrockonline.com and you can find all my socials there and you can check out my reel and you could listen to the entirety of Video Palace. And maybe one day I'll even have a link to the project I'm working on now that I can't talk about yet.
Yay. I can't wait for that day.
How about yourself?
Well, I joined your Needs a Werewolf club, but I haven't yet investigated. But I do see them sort of appearing in my feed now, and boy, it could be almost anything that needs a werewolf, turns out.
It's really true. Like, the sky is the limit when it comes to werewolf, and I say beyond. Like, I have a whole pitch for a Werewolves on the Moon project that I want to do. But,
Wow.
well, because in space, the moon is always full. Come on, man. Anyway, you know, the first astronauts, a lot of them were dogs. It actually makes a lot of sense when you think about it.
I love where this is going.
Okay, so, Ilya, so where can people find you?
They can find me over at Hot Rod Cameras, hotrodcameras.com. We're busily remodeling, and once all of the remodel is finished, I'll post and share something about it at the places. I'm moving stuff around and throwing things out and doing minor construction. It's good times. So yeah, it's a.
How long have you been in that building now?
5 years. For a long time.
That's so hard to believe.
I know. And I just renewed the lease for a few more, so we'll be there for a while.
It's just crazy to think about that, because I just remember like sitting in your old space and doing these interviews at the bar that you had in the old space. We would set up the two microphones there. We'd have people, you know, like Mike Mickens or Christian Siebalt or whatever sitting there. And, you know, it's just
crazy
that it's been 5 years.
Yeah, that was humble times. But that was actually our second space that after moving out of my garage. So garage to then a 300 square foot room and then a 2000 square foot space, so spread over two floors, and now we're like 7,000 square feet or something like that, and I don't even know how big the next building will have to be, but hey, a few years away. Don't have to think about that right now. I'm just remodeling. So anyway,
well, cool, man.
So find me over there. Let's thank some people. Who do we have to thank today?
Today I think we have to thank Ben Katz more than anyone else, man. We're putting him through the ringer on this episode. Ben Katz, our editor, who works hard to make us not sound like idiots. I think we set a record for false starts on recording the host wraps today.
You know what?
I think we absolutely set a record. Then we should obviously thank Alana Cody, who has been kicking all the ass. We have some amazing interviews still coming up. It's Oscar season, so we just luckily getting to talk to a lot of the people who've shot some of the movies that hopefully we'll be seeing in the Oscar race. We have a few coming up, so very excited about the ones we have coming up. And last and never least, Kays Alatrachi, who provided every scrap of music that you heard in this entire episode.
And you know what? I think we should also thank Assemble.tv. Assemble.tv, who we didn't do a shout out at the beginning, but I think, we, you know, as a company, we should throw them into our thank yous. They're offering all of our listeners a free month of their service if they use the promo code Cinepod, which is us, C-I-N-E-P-O-D. You throw that in there and you get a month free of their service. Hey, thanks so much, Assemble.tv.
Yeah, it's a great service, totally worth it. If you got a project coming up, hey, if you have a project that's only going to take you a month, you'll get like basically all their services for free for your entire project. It'll be great.
Indeed it will. So check out Assemble.tv.
So that about wraps us up.
Thank you so much for listening.
This has been the Cinematography Podcast, presented by Hot Rod Cameras. Find your next camera, lens, or accessory on the web at hotrodcameras.com. Don't forget to subscribe to our show on iTunes and connect with us on Facebook and Twitter. Thanks for listening.